Hey there, it's Joe Henry, the semi-retired guy again, bringing you another video on stock investing. Now in this video, I'm going to tell you what you need to know about 5G. Then I'm going to tell you about what companies stand to benefit the most from this new technology. Companies that you may later decide deserve a spot in your stock portfolio. So first of all, what exactly is 5G? What's all the hubbub about? Well, the current wireless network we've been using for 10 years or so is called 4G, or fourth generation long-term evolution. Now, in some locations, 3G is still the norm. However, the speeds that 4G and 3G networks support just aren't keeping up with our current technological demands. So, for example, applications like these driverless cars, Teslas, robotics, the smart electric grid, machine-to-machine communication, these all require faster network speeds. So 5G, or fifth generation of wireless networks, was created to meet these new demands. Now, in terms of speed, 5G is up to 100 times the speed of the current 4G networks. 5G also has extremely low latency, meaning what? Well, it's a nerd-like term, meaning there's little delay between when signals are actually sent and received. So for example, with 5G, websites should appear almost instantaneously after typing in their URL. So how does this work? Well, up until now, all cell phone networks were operating the same bands of the so-called electromagnetic spectrum. Now, 5G uses much higher frequencies on this spectrum than 4G. Frequencies which were previously only being used by satellites, radar, other military applications I can't tell you about or I'd have to kill you. The higher frequency millimeter waves, as they're called, they create new lanes on the communication highway. But there's only one problem. These waves are kind of fragile. They're easily absorbed by bushes, trees, buildings, other obstacles. Now, to get around this problem, many closely spaced base stations called small cells are going to be needed to be built. Now, there are currently around 100,000 cell towers in the United States. Fortunately, base stations that we're talking about are much smaller and require less power than traditional cell towers. And they can be placed on top of buildings and light poles. They don't need to be on top of cell towers. So there you have it, 5G in a nutshell. A faster wireless network, lower latency, higher reliability. A little more fragile than 4G, it requires base stations that need to be much closer to our smartphones and our smart devices. So now let's look at some of the ways 5G will improve your way of life and transform various industries. So entertainment, this is the most obvious application. You'll now be able to download full-length HD movies in a matter of seconds instead of 20 or 30 minutes, which is what it takes you now. Augmented reality. So what is this? This overlays virtual information onto a live view of the real world. So for example, there's goofy live selfie effects in Snapchat and Facebook. And for you gamers out there, Microsoft has recently released a new AR game, Minecraft Earth. And what makes this game different from the other AR games, like Pokemon Go, is a heavy emphasis on collaboration. So in this game, players collect virtual materials while walking around their neighborhoods. So these materials can then be used in construction projects with their friends. Sound pretty cool to you? Doesn't really float my boat, but that's just me. How about a new online retail experience? Wouldn't it be nice to be able to try on your clothes, shoes, glasses, etc. before we buy them online? Well, soon we will be able to with the help of augmented reality. The Converse shoes already has a clunky version of this already. And so does Warby Parker glasses, so expect these to become much more sophisticated as 5G becomes more available. How about cell phones? Well, 5G will permit 10,000 times the amount of traffic that cellular carriers are now carrying with no slowing or dropped calls. In many cities currently, mobile phone users are already experiencing slowdowns during busy times of the day. So 5G adds huge amounts of radio frequency spectrum, so there won't be any slowdown, at least not until we fill those new frequencies up. And when you type in a website on your cell phone, it will appear virtually instantaneously. Autonomous vehicles. Well, soon, your autonomous vehicle will be able to communicate with other autonomous vehicles on the road. So if a car up ahead makes a sudden stop, your car will find out about it right away and start braking as well, hopefully preventing a collision. Yes, that man behind the wheel is actually sleeping. Now in healthcare, this is pretty exciting. For surgeons, for example, augmented reality will help provide 3D images and other vital information while the surgery is actually happening. In the same way that heads-up display helps pilots understand what's happening without having to look away from their surroundings to look at some control panel. So that's a quick summary of all the amazing applications that 5G will make possible. You may ask, well, who cares? All I want to know is how can I make some money on this new trend? Well, first it might be helpful to go back to California to the year of 1849, the time of the California Gold Rush. Well, why do I mention that time? Because I just wanted to point out the fact that the people who really made the big money back then, they weren't the miners, but actually the merchants. Those guys who actually sold the picks and shovels. Same thing in 2020, the big winners are not going to be the telecom providers. Those companies that have to take all the risk of setting up the new 5G networks, hoping their customers will come, hoping they can charge enough money to cover their cost plus a nice margin on top. So instead, I would look at the picks and shovels of the 5G. For example, chip makers, handset makers, etc. First on our list of industries to look at then are the fiber optic cable manufacturers. Fiber optic cable is the backbone of 5G. More of this will be needed to connect not just the traditional cell towers, but also the additional base stations, those smaller stations that are mounted on light poles, buildings, etc., that we talked about earlier. Now, who makes fiber optic cable? Well, Corning is the largest manufacturer of fiber optic cable in the world. They've got over 1.2 billion miles of their fiber optic cable currently installed around the globe. They actually invented optical fiber in 1970. And their optical communication segment represents about 40% of their sales. Corning's got a $16 billion market cap and a 3.9% dividend. Sweet. Now, in terms of financial trends, the latest quarter revenues were down 11% from a year ago, while earnings declined 50%. Management said optical communication sales declined, consistent with their expectations. Sales were impacted by the coronavirus, of course. However, Corning believes that their long-term growth drivers do remain intact. Operating margin was 6.9%, which has been narrowing over the past 3 years. That's not a good sign, either. We like to see this expand over time. Now, in terms of financial strength, operating cash flow was up 1.4% from a year ago. This is actually a much better indication of financial strength than earnings because it's simply harder to fudge. Now, what about Corning's valuation? Their PEG ratio is not meaningful with negative earnings growth, but their price to book is 1.43 versus their 4.7 in the peers. Fair value of 20 bucks by CFRA, the current stock price is 27. My conclusion, stock is somewhat overvalued, has shrinking margins, so I would not advise buying it at this time. My recommendation would be to wait for a dip in the overall market before looking at this one again. Okay, the 5G chipset and modem providers. Qualcomm is the dominant manufacturer in this space. They control 40% of the market. Now, Qualcomm derives most of its revenue from chip making, but the bulk of its profit actually comes from its patent licensing business. It basically has over 130,000 patents. The Qualcomm Snapdragon system on a chip is found in several leading cell phones, like Samsung Galaxy, Google Pixel, and the LG phones. Apple just signed a new multi-year agreement with Qualcomm to supply it with 5G modems, putting aside a long legal battle I'm sure you've heard about, and forking over billions of dollars in withheld licensing payments to Qualcomm. Samsung already makes a 5G phone. Google is expected to produce one in the near future. Apple is expected to produce 4 5G phones later this year. All of these handset manufacturers will be using Qualcomm chips and or modems. But the attractive growth opportunities for Qualcomm's go beyond just smartphones. Like we talked about before, autonomous vehicles, the Internet of Things, robotics. These are just a few of the areas where Qualcomm sees a lot of potential for its chips. Now, Qualcomm has a market cap of $89 billion, a dividend of 3.33%. And in financial trends, its latest quarter, they posted revenue and earnings up 4% and 14% from a year earlier. Wow. In terms of management effectiveness and profitability, their operating margins have been widening, not narrowing, over the past 3 years. Financial strength, their operating cash flow is up 10% from the previous 12 months. Valuation, is it a good buy at this price? Well, its PEG ratio is double its peers. Its price to book is 3 times its peers. Fair value by CFRA is $69 versus the current price of $79. Well, what do I say? Good stock, too high price right now. Wait for the next dip. All right, next we're going to talk about the networking equipment category. So Cisco Systems, as a supplier of networking equipment to telecom companies around the world, Cisco will be one of the key enablers of 5G technology. The company's 5G Now portfolio will give service providers and mobile providers the access to key elements needed to enable 5G connectivity using a single platform. So 20 service providers and mobile operators are already using Cisco's platform in their 5G plans. In terms of market profile, Cisco's got a $201 billion market cap, dividend yield of 3%. In its latest quarter, they reported revenue, which was down 8% year over year, but above the consensus forecast. Earnings were up 1% year over year. Now on the plus side, the COVID-19 pandemic has driven companies to digitize their operations and support remote workforces at faster speed and greater scale. So this has increased demand for Cisco's networking and collaboration solutions. It's also expected that remote and off-site working will increase in general, even as the pandemic begins to recede, which should also help Cisco. Nonetheless, the unprecedented decline in global GDP negatively impacted Cisco's overall demand, and the company has guided cautiously for the last quarter of 2020. In terms of management effectiveness, its operating margins widened slightly, which is good. Operating cash flow is up 16% from year previous. In terms of valuation, it's slightly overvalued by price to book and PEG ratio. Fair value by CFRA was $39, Morningstar $48, currently priced at $47.83. Well, is it a buy? Well, good management effectiveness as evidenced by increased in revenues, operating margins, and return on equity, but it's frankly getting to be fully valued. It has also had a big run-up in the past month. It's actually been up a little bit over 10% in the past month. And if you buy a stock that's fully valued or overvalued, you don't have a safety net if things turn south again. So again, my recommendation on this one, buy on the next significant dip. Finally, 5G handsets. We're going to talk about Apple. We come to one of the most hated stocks on Wall Street, which has nonetheless returned over 150% to investors over the past 5 years. In spite of all that hating, and in spite of the fact that most of us own at least one Apple product, self-disclosure, I own 5. And for those of you who live in a cave, let me tell you about some of the key products and services that Apple provides. His products include Mac desktops and laptops, iPhones, iPads, Apple Watches, various consumer products including AirPods, Beats, headphones, Apple TV. Apple services include the App Store, iTunes, iCloud, Apple TV Plus. Well, you name it. Now, why do we bring up Apple in a discussion about 5G? Simple. Apple is expected to release 4 5G-capable iPhones in 2020, according to JP Morgan. Now, these new iPhones will likely roll out in the second half of 2020. Now, even if the 5G phones are not released this year, Apple is bound to do well anyhow. So let's look at our key financial metrics here. Financial trends. In its latest quarter, Apple posted quarterly revenue that was a 1% increase year over year, and earnings that not only beat consensus, but grew year over year. What? Yep, in spite of the worst global health crisis since 1918 and the closure of all of its retail stores outside of China, it still managed to do okay, thanks to a 23% year-over-year growth in wearables. You know, like the Apple Watch and the AirPods. I own a couple. 17% growth in services like Apple News, 23% growth in home and accessories. Now, iPhone sales, which is usually about 50% of revenues, were actually down 7% year on year. But they were above the revised expectations. Icing on the cake, Apple hiked its dividend by 6.5% and added $50 billion to its existing $40 billion share repurchase program. Operating margins were essentially flat. Now, return on equity was a whopping 55% versus 12% in its sector. Operating cash flow was up 5% from a year ago. Now, it should be mentioned that Apple has a balance sheet with a net cash hoard of $83 billion, which should enable it to withstand any downturn without blinking an eye. Now, this also differentiates it from its peers. It will also help support additional share buyback. In terms of valuation, the price to book and PEG ratios show the stock to be fairly valued. Fair value calculated by CFRA was $268, Credit Suisse $260, Argus $350, current price is $351. My recommendation, again, wait for the dip. Apple stock appears to be overvalued. Now, this is a top-notch company in the top-performing sector in the most respected stock market globally. Basically, the creme de la creme. So you will eventually have to pay up if you want this stock. And it is the type of stock you want to be in during a potentially volatile period in the stock market cycle. But with the ongoing pandemic, a possible second wave, and a possible vaccine on the horizon in the next 6 to 8 months. It's just too expensive right now for its financial metrics. So there you have it, the stocks you need to watch to get on this latest trend of 5G. An old-time fiber optic company, a chipset producer, a networking manufacturer, and finally, a handset manufacturer. Actually, you're getting much more than a handset manufacturer with Apple. Now, you may wonder why I spent all this time talking about four stocks and not rating any of them a buy. Well, my job is not just to make you money, but it's also to educate you and protect you from losing your hard-earned dollars. I think it's important to note that at the time of this video, the S&P 500 has increased 41% from its March lows. Now, not surprisingly, many companies are now overpriced, including the ones I told you about today. Nonetheless, as you well know, buying the dip has been a very successful strategy for the past 11 years. I don't think this time's any different. So when the next dip comes, these are the companies you want to look at. So I hope you enjoyed today's presentation. If you liked it, please give me a thumbs up and hit the subscribe button so you'll never miss another video. Finally, the disclaimer. The Semi-Retired Guy's videos and writings do not constitute financial advice in any way. Nothing published by the Semi-Retired Guy constitutes an investment recommendation, nor should any data or content published by the Semi-Retired Guy be relied upon for investment advice. I strongly recommend you perform your own independent research, due diligence, and or speak with a qualified investment professional before making any financial decisions.